nobody is there.
ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರಗೀತೆ ನಾಡಗೀತೆ ಲಲಿತ ಕಲಾ ಕಾಲೇಜಿನ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿನಿಯರಿಂದ.
ಜಯ ಭಾರತ ಜನನಿಯ ತನು ಜಾತೆ, ಜಯ ಹೇ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಮಾತೆ, ಜಯ ಸುಂದರ ನದಿವನಗಳ ನಾಡೆ, ಜಯ ಹೇ ರಸ ಋಷಿಗಳ ಬೀಡೆ. ಜಯ ಭಾರತ ಜನನಿಯ ತನು ಜಾತೆ. ಪತಂಜಲ ಗೌತಮ ಜಿನನುತ ಭಾರತ ಜನನಿಯ ತನು ಜಾತೆ, ಜಯ ಭಾರತ ಜನನಿಯ ತನು ಜಾತೆ. ಜಯ ಭಾರತ ಜನನಿಯ ತನು ಜಾತೆ. ಭಾರತ ಜನನಿಯ ತನು ಜಾತೆ, ಜಯ ಹೇ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಮಾತೆ, ಜಯ ಸುಂದರ ನದಿವನಗಳ ನಾಡೆ, ಜಯ ಹೇ ರಸ ಋಷಿಗಳ ಬೀಡೆ. ಜಯ ಭಾರತ ಜನನಿಯ ತನು ಜಾತೆ.
Good morning to you all. His Excellency, the Governor of Karnataka and the Chancellor of our University, Sri Vajubhai Rudabhai Walaji, Pro-Chancellor Sri Basavaraj Rai Reddy Ji, the distinguished recipients of honoris causa degrees, His Holiness 14th Dalai Lama and Srimati Pramoda Devi Odayar, members of the syndicate, academic council, former and present vice chancellors, teaching and non-teaching staff, invitees, parents, members of the media, and my dear students, I welcome you all to the 97th convocation, which is the convocation of the centenary year of the university. The University of Mysore has already completed the centenary celebrations, but still, I take this opportunity to remember with gratitude all the stalwarts who have contributed for the birth and development of this university during the course of the past 100 years. The University of Mysore has been in the forefront of higher education. It strives for excellence in teaching and research. Our university has been recognized by several state, national, and international agencies, which have accorded various distinctions like Institution of Excellence, University with Potential for Excellence, Promotion of University Research and Scientific Excellence, etc., for its continued achievements. First and foremost, I pay my tributes to the then Maharaja of Mysore, Sri Nalvadi Krishnaraja Vadeyar, for establishing the university, which is the first in the state and sixth in the country. The galaxy of distinguished personalities who have served the university in its long history include the great educationist and former President of India, Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, Sri C.R. Reddy, Sri K.T. Shah, Dr. N.S. Subbarao, Professor B.M. Srikantaya, Professor A.R. Wadia, Dr. M.A. Gopalaswamy, and Poet Laureate Dr. K.V. Puttappa, to name only a few. Although the temptation is to bask in our past glory, we have resisted the same, because the best way of respecting the tradition is to formulate new programs according to the changing times. The University of Mysore is recognized for National Council of Science Museum. We have made Memorandum of Understanding with Hokkaido University, Japan, Chulakan University, Thailand, Ritz-Macon University, Kyoto, Japan, Anglia Ruskin University, UK, La Trobe University, Australia, University of Cambridge, United Kingdom, Daikin University, Australia, Harare Institute of Technology, Zimbabwe, Kingston University Higher Education Corporation of River House, United Kingdom, last but not least, the Ghent University, Belgium, in addition to the Member of Understanding with the existing institutions. His Excellency, the President of India, has enhanced the stature of university by inaugurating the centenary celebrations on 27 July 2015. I am extremely happy to mention that the University of Mysore successfully hosted the 103rd Indian Science Congress in January 2016 as a part of the centenary celebrations, where 10 Nobel laureates participated and the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Sri Narendra Modi ji, inaugurated the Indian Science Congress on January 3, 2016. This was a mega event where some 15,000 delegates participated. His Excellency, the Vice President of India, Sri Amit Ansari, delivered the valedictory speech during the concluding function of the centenary celebrations on 22nd July 2016. The government of Karnataka has magnanimously extended a fund of rupees 50 crore for the centenary celebrations of our university. We are galvanizing our efforts to be consistent in our achievements and stand the scrutiny of our peers in India and elsewhere, and we hope to realize the dream of making our university an outstanding institution of learning. According to the recent Scopus scientific estimation of all the Karnataka state universities, publications and H-Index has placed us at the top with 6,976 citations of publications, with 69 as the H-Index. The University of Mysore stands number one. The centenary year in the life of a university is a momentous occasion, and we are proud to share that we have to be accomplished things that are worthy of being celebrated by posterity. we have been able to realize our wish according to the strength, vitality and vision bestowed to us by nature at this point in nature. But let me place and record in all humility that we have lived up to the expectations of our superiors and fellow citizens. With these few words, I request His Excellency, the Governor of Karnataka and Chancellor of the University, Sri Vajubhai Rudabhai Walaji, to declare the 97th convocation open.
I declare open the convocation.
I request the Pro-Chancellor to continue further.
This convocation of University of Mysore has been called to confer the honoris causa degree on His Holiness 14th Dalai Lama and Srimati Pramoda Devi Wadiyar, and to confer the degrees to the candidates who have passed their respective examination held for the purpose and have been certified to be worthy of the same. Next also. Let the candidates be now presented.
Your Excellency, it's my proud privilege to introduce to you the Nobel laureate, His Holiness the 14th Dalai Lama, the spiritual and temporal leader of Tibetan people and a great personality and the recipient of Nobel Peace Prize. His Holiness the 14th Dalai Lama was born in a small village called Taxter in northeastern Tibet to a peasant family, and he was recognized as the reincarnation of his predecessor, the 13th Dalai Lama, at the tender age of 2, according to Tibetan tradition. His Holiness began his education at the age of 6 and completed the Geshe Larpa degree, doctorate of Buddhist philosophy, at the age of 25. At 24, His Holiness appeared for the preliminary examination at 3 monastic universities, namely Dripung, Shera and Ganden. His annual examination was held in Jokhang, Haza, during annual Monlan festival of prayer. In the morning, he was examined by 30 scholars, in the afternoon by 15 scholars on the subject middle pa, and in the evening he was examined by 35 scholars on the canon of monastic discipline and metaphysics. His Holiness passed all those examinations with honors before vast audience of scholar monks. His Holiness assumed the reign of full political power as head of state in 1950. During the period, the Tibet was threatened by the might of China. During his visit to India in 1956, when he participated in 2500 Buddha Jayanti, he had a series of meetings with the then Prime Minister of India, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, about the deteriorating conditions in Tibet. And during 1959, he was forced into exile in India after the Chinese military occupation of Tibet. After his exile, that is from 1960, he is residing in Dharmasala, known as Little Haza, the seat of Tibetan government in exile. During early years of his exile, His Holiness appealed to United Nations on the question of Tibet and was successful in adopting 3 resolutions by the General Assembly in 1959, 1961, and 1965. His Holiness promulgated draft constitution for Tibet in 1963, which assumes a democratic form of government. During last 2 decades, His Holiness established educational, cultural, and religious institutions, resulting in major contributions towards the preservation of Tibetan identity and its heritage. The 14th Dalai Lama proposed a 5-point peace plan in 1987 at the Congressional Human Rights Caucus as an initial step to resolve the future status of Tibet and this initiative is known as designation of Tibet as a zone of peace to end the massive transfer of ethnic Chinese into Tibet. Restoration of fundamental human rights and democratic freedom and the abandonment of China's use of Tibet for nuclear weapons production and the dumping of nuclear waste, as well as earnest negotiations on the future of Tibet and relations between the Tibet and Chinese people. His Holiness elaborated this 5-point peace plan at Strasbourg, France on 15 June 1988 and proposed for the creation of a self-governing democratic Tibet with the People's Republic of China. His Holiness visited United Kingdom, the United States of America, Canada, Western Europe, the Soviet Union, Mongolia, Greece, Japan, Thailand, Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, Costa Rica, Mexico, the Vatican, China, and Australia, and met the religious leaders from over 60 countries. His Holiness met with the late Pope Paul VI at Vatican in 1973 and His Holiness Pope John Paul II in 1980, 82, 1986 and 1988. Recognizing his rich contributions and distinguished writings in Buddhist philosophy and human service in the field of freedom and peace, over 200 universities from all over the world have conferred honorary doctorate degree on him. He was awarded Nobel Peace Prize in the year 1989. He has authored more than 100 books so far. He has been the champion of world peace, and he is the most recognized and respected personality who is advising peace to the people of the world. Your Excellency, this is His Holiness, the 14th Dalai Lama, a doyen of mankind and God's representative of peace. May I request His Excellency to confer the honorary doctorate of Doctor of Literature, honoris causa, on this very distinguished personality.
Thank you.
Your Excellency, I am indeed happy to introduce to you Srimati Pramoda Devi Vadayar, wife of late Shikantadatta Narasimhraja Vadayar, scion of erstwhile royal family. Srimati Pramoda Devi was born on 27th October 1953 to Srimati Puttaratnamani and Sri Venugopal Raj Aras from Bettadakote family of erstwhile princely state of Mysore. She did her graduation from Sharda Vilas College, Mysore, and post-graduation in Hindi from the University of Mysore. Srimati Pramoda Devi married to His Highness Sri Shikantadatta Narasimhraja Vadayar on 2nd February 1976. As rulers of Mysore, which has a hoary history of over six centuries, the royal family was greatly devoted, was religious bound in tune with the royal heritage of Yadu dynasty. After the demise of His Highness Shikantadatta Narasimhraja Vadayar on 10th December 2013, Srimati Pramoda Devi Vadayar had to shoulder great responsibilities. She rose to the occasion, and with her vast reading and perception, she is discharging her duties with vigor and aplomb. Her strong will and steadfast dedication to enduring values coupled with intelligence, she has succeeded in her endeavor to carry forward the tradition and legacy of Yadu dynasty. Srimati Pramoda Devi is a patron and president of Sri Jayachamraja Arasu Education Trust and was instrumental in developing and transforming it as one of the elite educational institutes. Srimati Vadayar is a distinguished entrepreneur, and she has designed the centenary logo of the University of Mysore with vision and artistic augment. Your Excellency, this is Srimati Pramoda Devi Vadayar, member of the erstwhile royal family, whose forefather established the university in 1916, and ever since the university has grown, bearing the stamp of mobility and honor. May I request His Excellency to confer the honorary doctorate of Doctor of Literature, honoris causa, on Srimati Pramoda Devi Vadayar. ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ಮೊಬೈಲಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾರೂ ರೆಕಾರ್ಡ್ ಮಾಡಬಾರ್ದು. ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಡೋಂಟ್ ರೆಕಾರ್ಡ್ ದಿ ಪ್ರೊಸೀಡಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಯುವರ್ ಮೊಬೈಲ್ಸ್. ಇಟ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ಲಿ ವಾರ್ನ್ಡ್. ಕೈಂಡ್ಲಿ ಟೇಕ್ ನೋಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್.
ರಾಜಣ್ಣ ಎಂ PhD ಜೈನಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ ಮತ್ತು ಪ್ರಾಕೃತ, ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ AN ಉಪಾಧ್ಯಾಯ ಚಿನ್ನದ ಪದಕ. ತೆಂಜಿನ್ ಎಕನಾಮಿಕ್ಸ್ LP ಗಿರೀಶ ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಕೇಷನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಜರ್ನಾಲಿಸಮ್. LP ಗಿರೀಶ ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಕೇಷನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಜರ್ನಾಲಿಸಮ್. ಮಂಜುನಾಥ ಸಿ, ಈಸ್ ಎ ಬ್ಲೈಂಡ್ ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್. Earned his PhD in political science. Manjunatha C, a blind student, earned his PhD in political science. ಸ್ನಾತಕೋತ್ತರ ಪದವಿ ವೇದಾವತಿ. ಇವರು ಒಟ್ಟು 7 ಚಿನ್ನದ ಪದಕಗಳನ್ನು ಪಡೆದಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಮತ್ತು 4 ದತ್ತಿ ಬಹುಮಾನವನ್ನು ಪಡೆದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ವೇದಾವತಿ MA ಅರ್ಥಶಾಸ್ತ್ರ, 7 ಚಿನ್ನದ ಪದಕ, 4 ನಗದು ಬಹುಮಾನ. ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರು ಬಸವಲಿಂಗ ಸ್ವಾಮಿ, MA ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತ. ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರು ಬಸವಲಿಂಗ ಸ್ವಾಮಿ, MA ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತ. ಇವರು ಒಟ್ಟು 9 ಚಿನ್ನದ ಪದಕಗಳನ್ನು ಮತ್ತು 2 ನಗದು ಬಹುಮಾನಗಳನ್ನು ಪಡೆದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರು ಬಸವಲಿಂಗ ಸ್ವಾಮಿ, MA ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತ, 9 ಚಿನ್ನದ ಪದಕ, 2 ನಗದು ಬಹುಮಾನ. ಸ್ನಾತಕ ಪದವಿ ಕಾವ್ಯ ಎಸ್ BAಯಲ್ಲಿ 3 ಚಿನ್ನದ ಪದಕ, 3 ನಗದು ಬಹುಮಾನ. ಅಲಮೇಲಮ್ಮ LH ರಾಮಾನುಜ ಅಯ್ಯಂಗಾರ್ ಚಿನ್ನದ ಪದಕ, ಮಳವಳ್ಳಿ ಗಾರೆ ವೀರಯ್ಯ ಲಿಂಗಮ್ಮ ದತ್ತಿ ಚಿನ್ನದ ಪದಕ, ಅಜಿತ್ ಸೇಠ್ ಚಿನ್ನದ ಪದಕ, ಲೇಟ್ ಎಸ್ ಕಪ್ಪಣ್ಣ ಸ್ಮರಣಾರ್ಥ ನಗದು ಬಹುಮಾನ, ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಜೆ ಶಶಿಧರ್ ಪ್ರಸಾದ್ ಸನ್ಮಾನ ಸಮಿತಿ ನಗದು ಬಹುಮಾನ, ಅಯ್ಯನಹಳ್ಳಿ ಚನ್ನಬಸಪ್ಪ ಮಹಾರಾಜ ಕಾಲೇಜು ಶತಮಾನೋತ್ಸವ ದತ್ತಿ ಬಹುಮಾನ. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ವೆರಿ ಮಚ್.
ಪ್ರೊಚಾನ್ಸಲರ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಿಟಿ ಆಫ್ ಮೈಸೂರ್, ಐ ಅಡ್ಮಿಟ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಹೋಲಿನೆಸ್ 14th ದಲೈ ಲಾಮಾ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಶ್ರೀಮತಿ ಪ್ರಮೋದಾ ದೇವಿ ವಡಿಯರ್ ಟು ದ ಆನರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಕಾಸಾ ಡಿಗ್ರಿ ಟು ದ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಲಿಟ್ರೇಚರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಕ್ಯಾಂಡಿಡೇಟ್ಸ್ presented to the degree of Bachelor of Arts, Bachelor of Fine Arts, Bachelor of Performing Arts, BA in Chinese Language and Literature, BA in Tibetan Language and Literature, Bachelor of Social Work, Master of Music, Master of Fine Arts, Master of Social Work, Master of Arts, Master of Communication and Journalism, MA in Theology, Peace and Conflict Resolution, Bachelor of Commerce, Bachelor of Business Management, Bachelor of Business Administration, Bachelor of Company Secretaryship, Bachelor of Tourism and Hospitality, Master of Business, Master of Commerce, Master of Management in Non-Profit Organization, Master of Business Information Technology, Master of Business Administration, MBA Agribusiness, MBA in Corporate Social Responsibility, MA in Hospitality and Tourism Management, Integrated MBA in Pharmaceutical Management, Master of Financial Analysis and Management, Master of Tourism and Administration, Bachelor of Education, Bachelor of Physical Education, Bachelor of Science Education, Bachelor of Arts Education, Bachelor of Elementary Education, Master of Education, Master of Physical Education, Bachelor of Laws, Bachelor of Academic Laws, BA LLB Honors, Master of Laws, Bachelor of Science, Bachelor of Science Speech and Hearing, Bachelor of Science Family and Community Science, Bachelor of Architecture, Bachelor of Computer Applications, Bachelor of Technology in Information Technology, Master of Science Information Technology, Master of Science Food and Technology, Master of Science Speech and Hearing, Master of Science Audiology, Master of Science Speech Language Pathology, Master of Special Education Hearing and Improvement, MSc in Bioinformatics and Applied Biotechnology, MSc in Cancer Biology, M.Tech in Computer Cognition Technology, M.Tech in Computer Science and Technology, MS Animation, M.Tech in Urban and Regional Planning, Master of Library and Information Science, M.Tech in Information System and Management, Master of Computer Applications, Master of Architecture Urban Design, MS in Computer Science and Technology, 5 years Integrated MSc Physics, 5 years Integrated MSc Chemistry, MSc Technology by Research in Computer Science, Master of Philosophy, Doctor of Philosophy, and in token thereof, they have been presented with these degrees.
His Excellency the Chancellor, I request the recipients of the Honorary Sir Kasa degree to deliver the acceptance speech.
Good afternoon to everyone. Chancellor, University of Mysore, His Excellency, Sri Vajubhai Rudabhaiwala, Pro-Chancellor, Sri Basvaraj Rai Reddy, Vice-Chancellor, Professor K.S. Rangappa, the members of the syndicate and academic council, ladies and gentlemen. I should admit that I was a bit stunned. When I learned about my nomination. Nonetheless, I'm happy and humbled as I stand here today to accept this honor. I also feel a deep sense of humility to be counted in the role of honor with my distinguished fellow honoree, His Holiness, Sri Dalai Lama. As we all know, this university was established in the year 1916. During the progressive reign of the then Maharaja of Mysore, His Highness Sri Nalvadiksha Rajwadya. His successor, my late father-in-law, His Highness Sri Raicham Rajwadya, and my late husband, Sri Srikanthatha Narasimha Rajwadya, were among the distinguished alumni of this university, both of whom have gold medals to their credit. I'm also an alumnus of this prestigious university, but I missed making it to the list of gold medalists by Visca. It gives me immense pleasure today to represent this illustrious family and the heritage. I have strived to ensure to live up to the set standards and to carry forward the unique cultural legacy and the living heritage. I feel incredibly proud to accept this honor, and I wish to dedicate this honor to my predecessors and the founder of this university, His Highness Sri Nalvadiksha Rajwadya. I express my gratitude to the Chancellor, the Vice Chancellor, members of the Syndicate Academic Council of University of Mysore for conferring the honorous cause on me. It's a great pleasure to share this special day with you all. Thank you.
Neha Sharan, highest gold medal in chemistry, please
kindly come on stage and receive the medals from the dignitaries. Neha Sharan. She has won 20 gold medals, 20 medals and cash prizes.
His Excellency, the Chancellor,
I request His Holiness 14th Dalai Lama, spiritual leader of the Tibetan people, to deliver the convocation address.
Oh, this light, is it too strong? Necessary? Oh, like this. Okay, now. Oh. Thank you. Too strong light. Just here. I cannot see the beautiful faces of these audience or students. Respected Chancellor, where?
Governor,
Chancellor, and respected professors and teachers. And rest of friend. Usually I prefer just to say human brothers, sisters. I really believe that. It's different rank, different costume. It's artificial, superficial. Oh. Deeper level, we are same human being. 7 billion human beings on this planet, same. Emotionally, mentally, physically, we are same. Now, particularly, time come, we must stress, we are same human being. Different nationality, different color, different family background, and a different position. These are secondary level of differences. Because I think many problems, besides nature problem, many problems actually we created, we human being created. On the basis, on the level of differences. Different nationality, different sort of color, different system, and it even using different faith, and a different sort of position or rank. So therefore, only way to reduce this
problem is we must go deeper where we are, same human being. I want a happy life. The entire humanity also want happiness. 7 billion human beings, each one have the right to achieve happy life. If in each individual sort of interest, the joyfulness, you see, materialize, then I think man-made conflict certainly will reduce, if not completely eliminate. So therefore, I always say, stress, we are same human being. Don't consider me, Dalai Lama, something special. No, I also have the problem of these emotions. And sickness, you see, my knees, you see, my sickness, you see, no exception of His Holiness Dalai Lama. Same, we are same. I think, if may I say so, Governor also, I think, same human being. So, some old age, these things come same way. So in any way, indeed, I'm very, very happy and great honor to participate in this because of convocation ceremony in one of the oldest university in this country. Wonderful. And also, you see, me personally, and also I think around, I think, 40,000-50,000 Tibetan refugee community live in this state since Jawaharlal Nehru. And late Mr. Nichalingappa. Because of these people, you see, we develop some special connection with this state. So therefore, I feel very happy. And then also, you see, I must sort of, because of the express appreciation, you give me this kind of honorary degree. But this morning I met one Khasa, one journalist. I mentioned the receiving degree without much work. So young student, I think in order to get this degree, I think you really work very hard. So I very much appreciate. And then also among the sort of, because of the gift or something, this watch, very nice, thank you. I think I want to tell you one story. When I was very young, the American President Roosevelt, you see, one sort of American, or say the mission, I think Tolstoy, you see, came to Lhasa. And actually with letter from president and one pocket watch and some other things. So as a young monk, you see, I have no interest about the letter of the president, only the watch. So that letter, I never pay attention about that letter. Only recent years, one occasion meeting with Obama, you see, he gave me the copy of that letter. Then I sort of saw that letter. Otherwise, you see, I think more than, I think, 50 years. But that watch, I always keep with me. So thank you very much. Then, education, of course, very important. for humanity, for human being. Even their sort of, their level of nationality or something, country. I think those country are more advanced in education, the more development. Education remain behind. The country also remain a little bit backward. So education, very important. So this university, I think made tremendous sort of contribution for development of this country, I think. However, a person whose age now 81 year old, age very young, I think 6-7, I already started education, mainly Nalanda tradition, philosophy, logic, and many other subjects. So at that time also, it is great burden. I have no interest about study. Only interest is play. So anyway, I think some kind of burden started my age, correct? 6-7. Of course, later I really found this knowledge, which I study with great sort of laziness. I think I found very, very useful. Then the age 16, my freedom lost. Age 24, I lost my own country. There are a lot of sort of suffering inside Tibet. In the meantime, 6 million Tibetan people trust me. So always put hope on me. So mentally, yes, you see, the more you see they showing hope, trust, mentally, more sort of the responsibility. But I cannot do much. So whole my life, you see, a lot of problem, a lot of suffering. But during the, and then after I become refugee. One way, you see, we Tibetan are refugee. One way, I am the longest guest of Indian government. So it's an opportunity meeting with different people, with a different sort of profession, different background. Then, gradually, I learned, and also same view expressed many my friend, scientists, educationists, and thinkers at a social sociologist, and so on. Today, we are facing some kind of crisis of moral principle. So that if we rely on religious belief, of course all religions have the same potential to create moral principle. Wonderful. But today's world, out of 7 billion human beings, 1 billion non-believer. Then frankly speaking, among the 6 billion believer, there are some strange believer also there. So actually I think mischievous religious people also there. Among Tibetan also there. So this clearly shows lack of moral principle, so that their faith or the name of the religion also is used for negative way. So therefore, then you see, we have to think seriously how to bring moral principle through prayer. No, I am Buddhist monk. Of course, my daily sort of practice about 5 hours sort of prayer and meditation, mainly analytical meditation, as a follower of Nalanda tradition. So we really use our intelligence maximum way, through that way transform emotion. That's a Nalanda tradition. However, just pray to God, to Buddha, will not bring moral principle on this planet. So, through drugs, through injection, through surgery, no. Only through education. So, the existing education system, frankly speaking, not adequate. So-called modern education, very much oriented about material value, external value. So look, generation who come through that kind of education, now facing this moral crisis, facing. The individual person may be billionaire, but not necessarily happy person. Lot of stress, lot of fear, lot of doubt. So this, and then no matter how good system, economy or political or many fields, no matter how good system, due to lack of moral principle among the people who deal these sort of system, no matter how sort of good system, eventually the same way, sort of negative, fail to fulfill the original sort of idea, right? Like that. So therefore, now the education is the only way to bring more moral principle. That also not based on religious faith. 1,000-year-old Indian tradition, secular. So according to Indian understanding, secular means respect all religions, not a negative attitude towards religion. Respect all religion. No preference, this religion or that religion. And also respect non-believer. I think that is really great. So therefore, the secular way to educate people about moral principle, mainly based on scientific finding and our common experience and common sense. We can teach from kindergarten up to university level. You see, this teaching of moral principle. Ultimate sort of base of moral principle is wholeheartedness. If you really take care of others' well-being and respect others' sort of right, that's the moral principle. Just self-centered attitude, I. That sort of mental attitude brings suspicion and distrust, and too much stress, and suspicion, then frustration, then anger, then violence. So more respect others' right, others' well-being. Then these negative emotions automatically reduce. So therefore, when we talk about moral principle, that is the sort of sense of concern of well-being of other. So therefore, we need in education field the explanation about these values. Over 30 years, I have sort of serious discussion with scientists. Recent years, some occasion, the scientists, through their investigation or observation, they say basic human nature is compassionate. This is the basis of our hope. If basic human nature is anger, then no hope. But basic human nature is more compassionate. Obviously, 7 billion human beings all come from their mother. All survived by parents' sort of affection, particularly mother's affection with the mother's milk. So all have the seed of compassion, affection. So therefore, on the basis of human nature, and that also happened because we are social animal. Social animal. Individual survival depend on others. So therefore, you must develop respect others. Others is the sources of your own happiness, your own successful life. So therefore, without touching any religion, not talking about heaven and hell, or Buddhist terminology, moksha, nirvana, not talking these things. Simply, how to build 7 billion human beings, more happier one, more harmony, more peaceful. Now, that's our aim. So that's, I always now talking, wherever I give some sort of talk, education field must include some education about our inner value and how to strengthen, how to strengthen or promote this inner value. So I hope this university, now fortunately, you see, in the West, in Europe, I mean in America, in Europe, and in particularly in this country, now more and more institutions, some individuals, some professors now really showing interest or actually working how to introduce in a modern education field about these moral principles strictly secular way. So we also use the word universal way, universal value. Because in the West, some people, consider secular means disrespect religion. Even some, some people, have the view secular, secularism and atheism, some connection. So atheism, anti-God, something like that. So therefore, we use the word universal value. So more and more people, now really showing interest is the importance of inner value. Then I often is telling my Indian friend, India, only this country have this sort of possibility or ability to combine modern technology, modern education, including science or these things, And then, with ancient Indian knowledge, how to train our mind more compassionate, more peaceful. So these ancient sort of Indian knowledge is your own knowledge. I think recent centuries, you neglected these things. Otherwise, the potential there. These are your own tradition. We Tibetans learned from you. We simply kept this knowledge over 1,000 years, more than 1,000 years. But actual sort of owner of this knowledge is you, Indian. When we judge most the great scholar of Nalanda institution, most of them South Indian. So I think ancient time, many South Indian, I think, made, I think, a lot of deep sort of human concept or philosophy by South Indian. So now modern South Indian, I think you should lead combination, ancient your knowledge and modern knowledge combined. Then you can make, I think, a significant contribution for world. That I want to tell you. And then, of course, congratulations, those young students. I think through the years, your effort, now you got the degrees. So now, I think after sort of finishing this is university sort of study these things, then real life begin. So life, there's no guarantee. Everything goes smoothly. There are a lot of problems, a lot of obstacles come. Then, not only this brain, smart brain, but also the warm-heartedness. Because warm-heartedness brings you self-confidence. And with warm-heartedness, you can carry your work honestly, truthfully, and transparently. As a social animal, trust is the basis of friendship. Friendship not come, this is very educated, very sort of great professor, and become sort of friend, question. This is billionaire and friendship, question. I think the people who become friend of this billionaire, they also quite smart. How much exploit their money. So genuine friendship, entirely based on trust. There is trust, friendship come. So the basis of trust is sense of concern of their well-being. Then trust come. So, in order to utilize your intelligence, your education, meaningfully, you need warm-heartedness. Okay. So that I want to share with you. If those young students feel my talk is not much meaning, then don't care about these talks, these points. If you feel, there's some interesting, then think more, and among yourself, more discussions. Okay. Now some scientists also, you see, very much agree or supporting or similar sort of views when I discuss these things. So therefore, please think more seriously. Thank you. Thank you very much. Then quite often, you see, I express I don't like too much formality. So now, we quite sufficient formality. Now, I think time end. Thank you.
I dissolve this convocation.
ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರಗೀತೆ ದಯಮಾಡಿ ಗಣ್ಯರೆಲ್ಲರೂ ಸಭಾಂಗಣದಿಂದ ನಿರ್ಗಮಿಸುವವರೆಗೆ ಸಭಾಸದರು ಅಣಿ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಡಬೇಕು. ನೂಕು ನುಗ್ಗಲಿಗೆ ಅವಕಾಶ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಫೋಟೋ ಸೆಷನ್ಗೆ ಅವಕಾಶ ಇಲ್ಲ. ದಯಮಾಡಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸಭಾಸದರು, ಕುಲಪತಿಗಳು, ಗಣ್ಯರು ಗೌರವ ಡಾಕ್ಟರೇಟ್ ಸ್ವೀಕರಿಸಿದ ಗಣ್ಯರು, ಕುಲಸಚಿವರು, ಪರೀಕ್ಷಾಂಗ